Mga kababayan, ang pambansang awit ng Pilipinas.
Thank you. nothing to lose. Fire away, fire away. Ricochet, you take your aim. Fire away, fire away. You shoot me down, but I won't fall. I am titanium. You shoot me down, but I won't fall. I am titanium. You who have further to fall. Ghost town and haunted love.
Makes you something that you're not, but you know inside what you are. And that question burns in your heart. How will you become that? I may be someone unique in this, but I am not alone. Not alone at all. So when I became a fashion model, I felt that I finally achieved the dream that I've always wanted since I was a young child. My outside self finally matched my inner truth. My inner self. For complicated reasons, which I'll get to later, when I look at this picture, at that time I felt like, Gina, you've done it. You've made it. You have arrived. But this past October, I realized that I'm only just beginning. All of us are put in boxes by our family, by our religion, by our society, our moment in history, even our own bodies. Some people have the courage to break free, not to accept the limitations imposed by the color of their skin or by the beliefs by those that surround them. Those people are always the threat to the status quo, to what is considered acceptable. In my case, for the last 9 years, some of my neighbors, some of my friends, colleagues, even my agent did not know about my history. I think in mystery, this is called a reveal. Here is mine. I was assigned boy at birth based on the appearance of my genitalia. I remember when I was 5 years old in the Philippines walking around our house, I would always wear this t-shirt in my head. And my mom asked me, how come you always wear that t-shirt in your head? I said, Mom, this is my hair. I'm a girl. I knew then how to self-identify. Gender has always been considered a fact, immutable. What we now know, it's actually more fluid, complex, and mysterious. Because of my success, I never had the courage to share my story. Not because I thought what I am is wrong, but because how the world treats those of us who wish to break free. Every day, I am so grateful because I am a woman. I have a mom and dad and family who accepted me for who I am. Many are not so fortunate. There's a long tradition in Asian culture that celebrates the fluid mystery of gender. There's a Buddhist goddess of compassion. There is a Hindu goddess, Hidra goddess. So when I was 8 years old, I was at a fiesta in the Philippines celebrating these mysteries. I was in front of this stage, And I remember out comes this beautiful woman right in front of me. And I remember that moment, something hit me. That is the kind of woman I would like to be. So when I was 15 years old, still dressing as a boy, I met this woman named TL. She is a transgender beauty pageant manager. That night she asked me, how come you are not joining the beauty pageant? She convinced me that if I joined, that she will take care of the registration fee and the garments. And that night, I won best in swimsuit and best in long gown and placed second runner-up amongst 40-plus candidates. That moment changed my life. All of a sudden, I was introduced to the world of beauty pageant. Not a lot of people could say that your first job is a pageant queen for transgender women, but I'll take it. So from 15 to 17 years old, I joined the most prestigious pageant to the pageant where it's at the back of the truck, literally, and or sometimes it would be a pavement next to a rice field. And when it rains, which it rains a lot in the Philippines, the organizers would have to move it inside someone's house. I also experienced the goodness of strangers, especially when we would travel in remote province in the Philippines. But most importantly, I met some of my best friends in that community. In 2001, my mom, who had moved to San Francisco, called me and told me that my green card petition came through, that I could now move to the United States. I resisted it. I told my mom, Mom, I'm having fun. I'm here with my friends. I love traveling, being a beauty pageant queen. But then 2 weeks later, she called me. She said, did you know that if you moved to the United States, you could change your name and gender marker? That was all I needed to hear. My mom also told me to put two E's in the spelling of my name. She also came with me when I had my surgery in Thailand at 19 years old. It's interesting, in some of the most rural city in Thailand, they perform some of the most prestigious, safe, and sophisticated surgery. At that time in the United States, you needed to have a surgery before you could change your name and gender marker. So in 2001, I moved to San Francisco. And I remember looking at my California driver's license with the name Gina and gender marker F. That was a powerful moment. I mean, for some people, their ID is their license to drive or even to get a drink. But for me, that was my license to live, to feel dignified. I mean, all of a sudden, my fears were minimized. I felt that I could conquer my dream and move to New York and be a model. Many are not so fortunate. I think of this woman named Ilan Nettles. She's from New York. She's a young woman who, courageously living her truth, but hatred ended her life. For most of my community, this is the reality in which we live. Our suicide rate is 9 times higher than that of a general population. Every November 20th, we have a global vigil for Transgender Day of Remembrance. I mean, I'm here at this stage because it's a long history of people who fought and stood up for injustice. This is Marsha P. Johnson and Sylvia Rivera. Today, this very moment is my real coming out. I could no longer live my truth for and by myself. I want to do my best to help others live their truth without shame and terror. I am here, exposed, so that one day there will never be a need for November 20th vigil. My deepest truth allowed me to accept who I am. Will you? Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Gina, one quick question for you. I'm wondering what you would say, especially to parents, but in a more broad way, to friends, to family, to anyone who finds themselves encountering a child or a person who is struggling with and uncomfortable with the gender that's being assigned them, what might you say to the family members of that person to help them become good and caring and kind family sure. members to them?
Well, first, really, I'm so blessed. I mean, the support system with my mom, especially, and my family, that in itself is just so powerful. I mean, I remember every time I would coach young trans women, you know, would mentor them, and sometimes when they would call me and tell me that their parents can't accept it, I would pick up that phone call and tell my mom, "Mom, can you call this woman?" And like, sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. So, but it's this gender identity is in the core of our being, right? I mean, we're all assigned gender at birth. So what I'm trying to do is to have this conversation that sometimes that gender assignment doesn't match. And there should be a space that would allow people to self-identify. And that's a conversation that we should have with parents, with colleagues. And the transgender movement, it's at the very beginning to compare to how the gay movement started. There's still a lot of work that needs to be done. There should be an understanding. There should be a space of curiosity and asking questions. And I hope all of you guys will be my allies.
Thank you. That was so lovely.
Thank you. Thank you.
The subject that we're going to deal with today is a particularly important topic, and I think it's very pertinent that we're dealing with it today on the International Human Rights Day, and that is the topic of grave human rights violations on grounds of gender identity or sexual orientation. The past decade has witnessed a continuous stream of reports of extrajudicial killings, torture, arbitrary detentions, and other gross human rights violations committed against fellow human beings on grounds of their gender identity or sexual orientation, or simply because of the fact that they have been human rights defenders of the rights of these people. The year of 2009, unfortunately, has been no exception. Throughout the year, we've had reports of such grave violations from all the six major world regions of North America, Latin America, Africa, Asia, Oceania, and Europe. None of us can say that we come from a country where these problems with very serious, grave human rights violations do not occur on a more or less regular basis. So we all have a stake in this issue. These flagrant violations of international human rights law far too often go unpublished, unnoticed, and therefore also unpunished. And in fact, I would say that the phenomenon of impunity is probably the most important element in this lethal cocktail of gross human rights violations. Now, on my right-hand side, I have Rogando Sassot, who is one of the leading voices of the transgender rights movements in the Philippines. In 2002, she co-founded the Society of Transsexual Women of the Philippines, the first and only transgender support and rights advocacy group in her country. In 2003 and 2004, together with Dr. Sam Winter and Mark King of the University of Hong Kong, she did the first comprehensive research work on Filipina transgender women, which was published in the International Journal of Transgenderism. During the 2007 Manila Pride March, she has been named as one of the 9 faces of Pride.
Let me begin by expressing my warmest gratitude to the permanent missions to the United Nations of Argentina, Brazil, Croatia, France, the Netherlands, Norway, and Sweden, and to the coalition of non-government organizations defending the rights of lesbians, gays, bisexual, and transgender people. Thank you for making this event possible and for giving us this opportunity to contribute our voices to this ongoing conversation for change. Our esteemed participants, beautiful beings and profound expressions of this universe, a warm, vibrant, and dignified afternoon to each and every one of you. Burned at stake, strangled and hanged, raped and shot and stabbed to death, throats slashed, left to bleed to death. These are just some of the ways transgender people were killed in different parts of the world, in different times in the history of our humanity. These are just the tip, the violent tip of the iceberg of our suffering. I can go on and on, reciting a litany of indignity upon indignity, but my time is not enough to name all the acts of atrocious cruelty that transgender people experience. But what is the point of counting the dead bodies of our fellow human beings, of narrating how we suffer, and of opposing violence against us if we don't challenge the root of our oppression? The sincerity of our intention to address the human rights violations against transgender people rests upon the depth of our appreciation of human diversity and the breadth of our understanding of why transgender people suffer these indignities. The root of our oppression is the belief that there is only one and only one way to be male or female. And this starts from our birth. Upon a quick look at our genitals, we are assigned into either male or female. This declaration is more than just a statement of what's between our legs. It is a prescription of how we should live and must live our lives. It is a dictation of what we should think about ourselves, the roles we should play, the clothes we should wear, the way we should move, and the people with whom we should have romantic and erotic romantic relationships. But this belief is so wrong, very wrong. The existence of people whose identities, bodies, and experiences that do not conform to gender norms is a proof that this belief is wrong. Nonetheless, even though the truth of human diversity is so evident and clear to us, we choose to hang on to our current beliefs about gender, a belief that rejects reality and forces people to live a lie. This is the belief that leads to attacks on our physical and mental integrity, to different forms of discrimination against us, and to our social marginalization. This is the belief that led to Joan of Arc to be burned at stake because she was cross-dressing. This is the belief that motivated the rape and murder of Brandon Tina on December 31, 1993. This is the belief that led to stabbing to death of Ebru Soykan, a prominent transgender human rights activist in Turkey, on March 10, 2009. This is the belief that led to the arrest of 67 Filipino workers in Saudi Arabia for cross-dressing in June this year. This is the belief that keeps the list of transgender people being harassed, killed, and violated growing year after year. And it is very unfortunate that our legal systems, religions, and cultures are being used to justify, glorify, and sanctify the violent expressions of this belief. So we question, is human life less precious than this belief? Is our right to life, to dignified existence, to liberty and pursuit of happiness, subservient to gender norms? This doesn't need a complicated answer. You want to be born, to live and die with dignity. So do we. You want the freedom to express the uniqueness of the life force within you. So do we. You want to live with authenticity. So do we. Now is the time that we realize that diversity does not diminish our humanity, that respecting diversity does not make us less human, that understanding and accepting our differences does not make us cruel. And in fact, history has shown us that denying and rejecting human variability is the one that has led us to inflict indignity upon indignity towards each other. We are human beings of transgender experience. We are your children, your partners, your friends, your siblings, your students, your teachers, your workers, your citizens. Let our lives delight in the same freedom of expression you enjoy as you manifest to the outside world your unique and graceful selves. Let us live together in the fertile ground of our common humanity, for this is the ground where religion is not a motivation to hate, but a way to appreciate the profound beauty and mysteries of life. For this is the ground where laws are not tools to eliminate those who are different from us, but are there to facilitate our harmonious relationship with each other. For this is the ground where culture is not a channel to express the brutality of our limited perception, but a means to express the nobility of our souls. For this is the ground where the promise of the universality of human rights can be fulfilled. And we will be in this ground if we let the sanity of our desires, the tenacity of our compassion, and above all, the lucidity of our hearts to reign in our lives. Thank you.